Welcome back to another exciting version of Hamilton's Computer Lifestyles, where things happen in the technology business and you get to find out about it. Tonight's trivia question is, what does CRT stand for? That's what does CRT stand for? So give us a call at 645-3232 when we open up the phone lines. And tonight we've got a special treat because we're going to be looking at using a modem package. So Lyle, I hope you're ready. And what I've got here is a laptop. I'm using the laptop with a regular monitor. And the laptop has a built-in modem. The modem is hooked up to a telephone line here, and we're going to transmit through the telephone line to the Computer Lifestyles bulletin board that we've set up for you guys. So we put in the disk that has our communications package on it, and we type AT, that stands for Anchor Talk, that's the program that we're using, and now it's loading up, and we're now going to connect to the bulletin board system. So now we've got, it tells us all the special information that the computer needs to know down in the bottom left. All I have to do at any time, if I say get confused with the program, is hit F1. And what that does is that brings up all the help information that I need on the special communications package itself. So I'll hit escape. And it tells us that we have to hit Alt-D for dial. And that brings up our, say, phone book. And in the phone book, we've got it already pre-entered in there, so that all I have to do at this point is just hit enter, and it puts the number in there. For any of you folks after the show, we'll be giving you the number. It's 527-5461, and I'll repeat it a little later. So now what we're doing, we're going and dialing, and we connected into the bulletin board system. And it tells us here that we are, thank you for calling this BBS. Fill out the questionnaire as follows. Now, because I've already been registered into the bulletin board system, it knows who the last caller was because I just finished calling it a few minutes ago. And there's a questionnaire that you have to fill out and get verified before you can get on the board itself. But make sure to fill that out or else you won't be able to get into the board. Now, that's interesting. You see what happened down at the bottom of the screen? This is what they call a problem because this is line noise that's going on the line. Now, it asked me if I spelled my name correctly, and obviously I didn't spell it correctly. So it's giving me a second chance, so we'll put in Mark. Well, it's still giving us a little bit of noise on the telephone line. Sometimes this happens, and it's nothing to really get upset about because it generally corrects itself, except when you're on live TV, of course. And again, it's asking me if it's spelled correctly, which it isn't. We seem to have a lot of noise on this line here. Okay, so it's going to disconnect me, so we get to... that is because someone was trying to call in at the same time we were trying to call out. Now what we'll try to do, we'll try to call again. There we go. And hopefully that problem won't occur again. The neat thing about bulletin board systems is that you'll be able to get information and leave messages for us, and we'll be able to get back to you on a daily type basis now. So again, it's going to go through the login and continue. That's my name. Somebody's trying to call in again. No. Well, this could be an interesting situation if this occurs for the next 5 minutes. Okay, we're gonna log off again and log in. It'll be really neat if I can get into it because there's a lot of information in here. No, somebody's really, really trying to call in on this line for some reason. Okay, maybe we're all set now. The interesting thing about bulletin board systems is the amount of information that you can get out of them. You can leave messages for your friends, you can talk to the person that's operating the system, and you can also gather public domain software. We had a few people asking about public domain software. And what we were doing is making sure that we could get all this for you. And now, da-da-da. Incorrect password. Quick, get it in. No. No, something wants to happen here. Yes. Well, we're in. Into the bulletin board system. Welcome to Computer Lifestyle, dedicated to computer education excellence. So now what, this is the introduction screen, and down at the bottom it always tells you what to do. C for continue, S for stop, and N for no stop. So we hit C for continue. So checking for new bulletins. What we're going to be doing is putting all the new bulletins, so all new information gets put in there. And you can enter this bulletin board, there's no charge for it. And enter to quit the bulletin board information. It also gives you a quote, the quote of the day. Beware of the man who works hard to learn something, learns it and finds himself no wiser than before. He is full of, ooh, that one's kind of wild. We'll skip that one. Murderous resentment. Not good. We'll have to take that one out of there, Lyle. But it's got thousands and thousands of things. Now we're coming up to the main menu. And what we'll have is a bulletin menu where we'll allow all kinds of information from computer clubs. They can put information on here to find out when the clubs are meeting and what they're talking about. There's a file menu in here, a message menu, and also who's on the system. And we'll also be putting our newsletter in here too, so that you'll be able to download the newsletter. Now, for those folks that don't understand what downloading is, what it is here, I'll just hit F to go to the file menu. And that's as simple as it is once you've logged in. If you've got a color monitor, then it comes up in color for you. You have to make sure to put the ANSI.sys file, which is a file that comes with your disk operating system. And in your config.sys file, config.sys, you put a command in there that says device equals, and then wherever it is, /ANSI.sys. And if you have any questions about that, then you can just call the board, and then it gives you a whole list of information there. So on the left-hand side, it says upload a file or download a file. Now, we won't actually be allowing uploads on this system, but we will be allowing downloads where you can download information. So in the message base, let's say you wanted a piece of public domain software, all you have to do is request it in the message base, and then we'll put that in your file, and then you can download it. And it'll also go through different searches. Like let's say we hit T for text and do a text search. So now it asks us if we want to do a fast search or a detailed search. So we'll say a detailed search. And it asks us here, enter which text to scan. Let's say we want to find a label program. So we'll ask it to find anything that has the word label in it. And it says enter areas or use the plus sign to find all of the different areas. So we hit the plus, and then it's going through each particular file to find the label programs. And there, we found one there that's prints labels, disk labels, and envelopes. And there's also one there called a Rolodex type telephone dialer and a mail management program and games and spreadsheets and education programs. We're going to be stuffing this full of education programs for everybody so that they can take education programs for their children right off of the bulletin board system itself. So we'll continue. So that's kind of interesting how you can just ask it, you know, what you want to put in the system itself. And it's got tutorials and all kinds of information. So now we can go back to the file menu system. And you can actually view the program too from this this type of system. And look at the new files and the old files. And we can hit Q to quit to go back to the main menu. And this has got to be one of the easiest bulletin board systems, and that's why we're working with this. It's a really easy system to use because the last thing you need is confusion. You can also talk. Now, there's only one line on this right now, but eventually when we get many lines, then you can talk to people while you're on the line itself. There's also a part in here for questionnaires and the comments to the system operator. And you can also get all kinds of other information from this. We'll be putting together a little tutorial package on how to use every different feature of the bulletin board, and of course we'll be adding to it for everybody. But the most important thing is if you have a question or anything, then you can tap in with your computer system and put a message in this, and this is something that I check on a daily basis, so therefore the questions will be answered on a daily basis. So what we'll do now is go off to an interview that we had in Toronto with Bose Fletcher from Colvox. And thanks a lot, Lyle, and off to the interview. This is Bose Fletcher. He's going to give us a little bit of a different demonstration on how the dictation works on the system itself.
Begin word perfect. Window on. Begin word perfect. Choose two. Begin document. Window on. Welcome to the Dragon Dictate speech recognition system. Running in WordPerfect to demonstrate some of its capabilities. Period. It will run any DOS software application, including word processing, comma, database, comma, or spreadsheet. Period. View document. Cancel, cancel, voice console, go to sleep.
That's excellent, Bose. How do you see this affecting the future?
Well, our company feels that voice input is the future of computer input. People will no longer have to learn how to type, and they can just speak what they want the computer to do.
So you could basically walk into your house, let's say, and turn on the lights.
Sure, systems like that already exist.
So maybe you can give us a little demonstration on how that would change, turn on the on and off the lights.
Okay, I have one set up on the table, so we'll do that now. Voice console, wake up, escape to DOS, load X10, turn lamp on, lamp off, quit X10. Exit. New line. Page up. Voice console. Go to sleep.
That's excellent. Now back to the show. And we're back.
Yeah.
That was pretty neat.
Mm-hmm. It's very good.
You know, John would really use that system, that Dragon system.
Very.
It's too bad it's so expensive, you know. But it's coming down in price.
Everything is.
Yeah, so that you can just talk. And you can do 80 words a minute by just talking, you know.
That was that Dan Thompson also that we had interviewed, too. He was doing the same thing. And he was quick, too. He wasn't using his own system, so it wasn't as fast. He said if he had his own system that he'd really, the speed as he was saying his words would really pick it up quickly.
Yeah, 80 words a minute.
Yeah, that's excellent.
Faster than I can type.
You but still that's do not faster surprising. Than me. You've been practicing more than me.
Yeah,
lately.
So what do you think of that?
That was a good show. It's a lot of fun, eh?
Yeah, well, it's neat. It's going to be really beneficial for everybody, you know. Mm-hmm. Get in and get messages and answer questions and all that neat stuff and get educational stuff and all kinds of fun.
Things there for people.
Yes.
Yeah.
A couple of things that that I'd like to talk to you guys about is I found out some more information on the VCR tape backup.
Okay.
And this is a great thing. For $200 and something, so you say $250, you can buy this card that fits inside your computer system. And what it does is you take the leads from this card, and then you put it right into your VCR, and it acts as a tape backup. You just use a regular VHS tape. It stores 110 megabytes. On a T120 tape. So you pay $7. Like, I mean, remember the tape backups we bought?
Or yeah, I remember.
Just the cassettes?
I remember.
You know, $30, right? These ones are just, you know, $7 on a regular VCR tape.
And then
tape.
They didn't work. I remember.
Yes. The fun with computers, eh?
Yeah, that's like, that was supposed to freeze out when you're doing it. It reminded me of the one
on
modem
TV,
show.
It only works.
It reminded me of the one modem show. Remember the modem show that we had, though?
Yeah.
And for a whole hour, someone was trying to
call in. Yeah.
But it was someone that knew somebody at the studio, so it was like, well, okay. Yeah. It wasn't done on purpose. I think we'll go to our first caller this evening, okay? Ready?
Okay. Ready.
Hi, Mike.
How you doing?
Good. How about yourself?
Fine, thank you. I have an IBM 286 AT, and when I clean up my C drive, okay, I always get, it seems that I always get this mystery file on there called MAHSTATS, M-A-H-S-T-A-T-S.
M-A-H?
S-T-A-T-S. And I erase it, and it seems to keep coming back, and I was just curious what it was, if you've ever heard of it before.
No.
No?
Mystery file.
From compressing, or...
Which compression are you using?
I've used PC Tools.
No, I've never heard of that file. I use PC Tools too, and it does create a mirror file. But it says it's called mirror.
Yeah, I know. It's just that it's like a file. I erase it all the time because I don't have no idea where it comes from. And I was just curious if you've ever heard of it before because I've seen it on a few computers actually. So I've gone in and I've looked through their. Look through people's, you know, C drive or whatever, and I've seen it in there, and I said, I had the same thing, and I know I didn't put anything in with that in there.
What's the extension on it?
There is no extension. It just says MAHSTATS, and then it has, it doesn't have dot, it has nothing. And then it's just, I don't know, a couple of numbers afterwards. It's not very big.
Right.
And I was just curious if you knew what it was.
No, that's interesting. I'll, M-A-H-S-T?
A-T-S, yes.
A-T-S.
And I've talked to a few people, and they said, one person said it might be from zipping and unzipping, you know, compressed...
Files?
Yeah. They said that you might get it from that, or...
I've never seen that before. Huh. It's not M-O-S, eh? It's M-A-H?
Yes, it's M-A-H.
It sounds like some type of, stats, you know, sounds like statistics of some sort.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll have to ask Dr. Computer about that.
All right.
I'll get back to you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Okay, bye.
Mike.
Hello.
Oh.
Hello.
What does CRT stand for?
CRT?
Yeah. The trivia question for tonight.
Oh, I have no idea.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
That's all right.
Bye.
Bye.
Yes. That's
so interesting.
Weird.
Well,
but then
somebody's put in.
We're in the computer industry.
And that's weird. Okay, let's go to another caller. Yeah. Hi, Sheila.
Hi.
How are you doing this evening?
Not bad, thanks. Now, I have an IBM compatible computer.
Mm-hmm.
When I turn it on, I have disk boot failure. Is that serious?
It may and not may okay. and may not be. You want to handle that?
No. I just thought you were going to say it's terrible. Everything's going to explode. I was just going to say, don't do that. That's all.
No,
go
we
ahead.
We can't alarm them. You know?
No, that's right. But you like to tease sometimes. Okay.
Me?
Go ahead.
Now, do you have a hard drive?
Yes.
Okay.
What may have happened is the files have gotten corrupted in the system area of the hard drive itself. Have you got a lot of information on the hard drive?
Yes.
Have you backed up your hard drive?
I haven't. I do have the copies, the original copies that were put on.
The original?
But I've never actually backed it up.
You've never actually backed up all your data?
Well, I just have programs on there. There's no other data that I don't use it.
Oh,
I very seldom use the hard drive.
Okay.
But when I do turn it on now, I'm getting disk boot failure.
Okay. What you have to do is you have to get a compression. Is it fairly old or?
No, about 5 years.
Oh, okay. And probably what's happened here. See, when DOS is writing to a hard drive, there's these three plate platters inside of the hard drive. And when DOS writes to them, it splatters all this stuff all over the place. It's what they call fragmentation. What it means is that there's bits and pieces of the files all over the disk.
Right.
And what you have to do in this case is take your disk operating system disk, boot from the floppy drive.
Right.
So it goes to A.
Right.
Then go to your C drive. You should be able to get to your C drive then.
Right.
Take a tool like PC Tools or Norton Utilities or something along that line with a compress file.
Right.
And what it'll do is it'll rearrange all of the files on the hard drive, so that way they're all connected. Now, if it's if you still get that problem, then you'll have to take the hard disk and reformat it, because what happens after, like if you've had it for 5 years, the magnetism really wears out on it, and because it's all magnetism, eh? And then you just reformat it. Make sure that you've got, get all the information off it that you want to save, like files, if you've got any letters or anything on there.
Right.
Save all of those onto a disk. And then if you've got the original disks, then you can just format the hard drive, put these files back onto it again, and you should be flying.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks.
Bye for now.
We'll keep in touch to see how you're doing.
Yeah, I should give her a call after
yeah.
the show and make sure, because yeah. those are a lot of steps to go through.
Mm-hmm. They are. That's how your hard drives crash, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's too much information. I've seen that. I've mentioned it, too, on the show before, though, where you've, what's the word, where you crunch everything?
Compress
everything, yeah.
Yeah.
And it takes, how long has it taken sometimes to compress on our computer?
Well, I did it this afternoon, actually.
Oh,
and it took over an hour.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've seen it happen like 3 hours. Is it finished yet?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's go to another call. Yeah. Hi, John.
Hi. How are you doing?
Good. How about yourself?
Hang on. I got to turn the phone off.
Okay.
Turn the phone off, then we're not going to be able to hear you.
I got the problem that fella had with the that mass deaths thing.
Right.
Uh-huh.
He got that Chinese dominoes game on his hard drive.
Oh.
Called Mahjong. It's like a domino game, only with Chinese symbols and stuff. And what happens is when you boot that up, it saves stats right in your root directory on your hard drive called Mahstats, M-A-H-S-T-A-T.
Ah.
Just beside it. What I mainly called for was the compression thing with the hard drive. Do you run that fairly often?
Yeah, you should. If you're saving a lot of files, at least once a month. You know, depending on if you've deleted a lot of files or added new files and that type of thing, or if you're doing a lot of saving all the time, which you should be doing, you know, sometimes do it once a week. You know, if you do it once a week, then it's not going to take as long, and that it really saves the life of the hard drive,
right.
Because you have to figure that in the hard drive, it's like a little record player,
mm-hmm.
and these things are with the platter spinning around, it's trying to find information on this side, on that side, and bring them all together.
Yeah, on the PC tools, you've got unfragment only, and then clear, and then there's three different ones. Which one should you use?
Which version are you using?
Six.
Yeah, there's one called called compressed disk. It's F4.
Mm-hmm.
In the you go to optimize or options, and then you go to the compressed file.
Yeah, but what I'm getting at is, do you have to go from like the start to finish, you know, where you do a disk scan and a file scan, and then you go to one fragment only, and then compression, just compression, and then there's compression clear, right, where it clears all the clusters out? You have to follow those step by step, or you just go right into compression and clear everything and then just do that the one time?
Generally, you can just go into compress,
mm-hmm.
and it'll take care of optimizing the directories and
mm-hmm.
sorting those out. However, sometimes if the disk is badly fragmented, it will say even go back and with DOS do a check disk /F, which goes in and fixes the clusters, bad clusters, takes them and puts them into a file.
Okay.
Or files, depending on how much it's fragmented.
Yeah, I got a good show there. I watch every Friday night when I can, and good show.
Excellent.
Great.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot,
John. Oh, do you know the answer to the trivia question, John?
No, I don't.
Okay.
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 Thanks. Have a good night.
You know something? That has to be one of the most important. Countless numbers of people.
Compressing the hard drive.
Yeah.
Yes.
Because when
it clears out the bad sectors and everything. Oh, getting better. Thank you for the answer for that Chinese domino game, though.
Yeah.
That's interesting. Because you put this game on your machine, it kind of just inserts itself. Okay.
It puts a stats
That's
in
That's Chinese.
The oh, Confucius say, stay in the root.
Okay.
Stay in the root.
Go to another call. Hi, Doug.
Hi. The girl with the disk boot failure on Drive C.
Uh-huh.
Right? One of the things she could do, usually unfragmenting won't correct a problem like that because it's usually a corrupt command comp file. And normally what she should do is, as you suggested, is boot with her original DOS,
mm-hmm.
and then type in sys space C colon, which will put back the two hidden files, and then say copy command comp. Space C colon, and that will normally, if the command comm is corrupted, that'll get the system back up and running.
Excellent. Yeah, that's
another thing.
Yeah, because what happens is it puts the command comm into another section
mm-hmm.
that isn't corrupted.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, so
there's a few. That's the one thing with computers is you have to try a few different ways sometimes to.
Yeah, that actually, Doug, that's probably the simplest thing to do. Is to just put the system sysc or, you know, just
mm-hmm.
type sys
mm-hmm.
and put the command comm on. How long have you been using computers, Doug?
Oh, about 7 years now.
So you must know what you're doing then.
Oh, a little bit anyway.
And do you know what the answer to the trivia question is?
I'm sorry, I just turned the TV on. I didn't even hear the trivia question.
Oh.
What is CRT? What does CRT stand for?
CRT. I would say it's, I don't know, cathode ray terminal.
That's close, cathode ray tube.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's good. Excellent.
Excellent.
Wish we had a prize to give you.
I like your show. It's terrific.
Great.
Thanks a lot, Doug.
Thanks
hey,
a lot.
Thanks.
Bye for now.
Bye-bye.
No.
Yeah, you know, there's... I should have thought of that. That's the simplest one.
Mm-hmm.
Is just put system on, put the command comm back on, because then it'll go into a different cluster. But make sure that after you do that, because that's a sign that the hard drive's getting weak.
Okay.
So,
so we
sure
can give her a call anyway. Tell her to
yeah,
try
make sure,
this,
make sure.
this way and see if it works out for her.
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Yeah,
thanks a lot, Doug.
Step by step, even walk through.
Yeah. Okay, next call. Hi, Dave. Ed?
Hi.
Hi.
You're watching TV Hamilton, Cable 14.
To another exciting version of Hamilton's Computer Lifestyles. I'm Mark Ironside, and we've got an exciting show for you this evening. Tonight we've got Len Price with us, who's a developer on the Amiga system and also an active member of the Hamilton Amiga Users Group, and we're going to have the president here a little later. The trivia question for this evening is an Amiga-type question. It's, what does HAM stand for? That is, what does H-A-M stand for? Now we're going to turn the show over to Len Price, and he's going to tell us all about the Amiga system and show us some very exciting things. So Len, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Mark. I'll start by informing the readers, or the viewers, exactly what kind of system we have here. We have an Amiga 2000 with 8 megs of memory. We have an accelerator card in here from Great Valley Products. We have two internal disk drives with a few hard drives inside. We have a CD-ROM reader. We have a removable media hard drive, and we have a tape backup. It's not your everyday standard system, but it's more like a graphic workstation setup. So I'll start off by showing the system what we have here. The Amiga lets the user choose exactly how you want to run it, as in, do you want to run icon-driven, like Max, or do you want to run through the CLI, which is more like IBM? We're given that choice, which is very nice. So I'll start off by showing exactly, this is our CLI. This is more of a technical way to run your Amiga. From here, we can type in commands, such as avail, to tell us what's available for our machine at this time, or we can scroll that window away and click on the icons. And right there, we're giving it all nice and graphical. We have a fuel gauge at the side to inform us exactly how much space is left on the hard drive instead of actually having to type in a CLI. From here, I'll go on and I'll show us exactly how we're going to run some graphic utilities with the Amiga. A good example of that is to use dpaint 3. I'll start it from Workbench. Why not? Right here, it's in a drawer. Not in that drawer. In our paint directory. And it has its own drawer all set up. We'll run dpaint 2. And here we have our choice of exactly how we want our screen to be represented. We'll choose high res. It's nice, it's the finest resolution we have to work with, so we don't have any jaggies, which are block representations of pixels. If we're using a lower resolution, you wouldn't see. If we're going to a circle here, it looks nice and smooth right now. If we went to a lower resolution, we change the resolution of the screen, and we did the same circle, we'd have a blocky, and that's what I meant by jaggies. You can see it down the side. DeepPaint 3 with the Amiga lets the end user be totally creative and be able to use do anything you want to do. If you want to do video tiling, if you want to do animations, if you want to just do simple text, it's all available right in DeepPaint 3. We'll do, let's see, I watched the logos as the show started up, and we'll do some new ones. Why not? Maybe we'll get a job here, eh, Mark? Good. Okay. We'll choose what kind of font we want. It's searching through the hard drive right now to go through as many fonts as I have. And we'll pick a nice one. Nice big one. We'll pick Chelt, size of 48. We'll clear the screen. We'll say, we'll type exactly in here what we want. Channel 14. Get rid of the screen. You can see it's too large for our screen. We'll go back to our high resolution graphics as we were at before. Now, the letters are nice and smooth and clean, but not big enough. So we'll clear the screen. We'll select a font that's larger. Again, it's going through the hard drive to look at what we have. I think I have too many fonts in there. One of the bigger fonts I have are right up here, 140 point high. So here we'll just say, we'll cut it down. Select a color, we'll select a nice blue. Type cable 14. That looks nice, but nothing's centered. This isn't a word processor, so we don't exactly have control over justification. So we can just pick things up as brushes and move them around all we want. Select the brush icon at the side, and I'll select our 14. I'll erase our old one, put it right there. Looks nice and centered. From here with the Amiga, we go directly out to video. You can put this on your video, your videos at home. If you're making a wedding or whatever, you could, you know, we could change this up. Change the icon. Select text again and say October 25th. And that could be a heading for your video. You can go anything like that. We'll go back to our idea of a new title for this show. We'll select that font again. We'll clear. We'll select blue, say cable 14. I'll again bring our brushes over. Erase what we have there. And put it exactly where we want. That looks really nice. But the whole power of the Amiga is we're able to do animation very easily also. So we'll select our menu and say, boy, how many frames should we make this? We'll make it a nice 30 frame attempt here. So we'll go up to Anim, we'll select frames. Set the number. We'll say, oh, we'll make it 15 frames. Fine. We have to tell what we actually want to animate. Do we want to animate the whole screen? No, we just want to animate the cable 14. So we'll pick up it as a brush. Yeah, we'll clear the screen. Cancel. We'll clear this screen. We'll place it where we want to start. We want to start right there. Very boring still. Let's do something with it. Let's tell it to move that brush around. Let's move it 360 degrees on its x-axis. Sounds a little technical, but you'll see the effects. It's very easy. Now, we'll go back there to move. And we'll tell it to 360 like we did. And we'll tell it, we'll get a preview of what actually is going to happen here. It's going to go in wireframe and show us that it's actually tumbling it over front. Not the exact thing we want. We'll go back. Select, we'll rotate it on the y-axis instead. And we'll preview it. Now you can see it's going side to side on the y-axis. It looks good enough. So we'll tell it, draw. Let's see what you got. Oh, it's going to draw right over top of itself. That's not the exact effect we wanted here. We'll let it continue, though. While it's calculating the perspective, you have to realize the Amiga is multitasking. So while this is taking mathematical functions in the Amiga, and it's going to take a while to do it, we'll just flip back to our front screen and say, boy, that's boring while that's doing that. Let's do something. I feel like listening to something. Let's see, what can we listen to? There's something around here. I have a little music example here, a little demo. And we're going through our workbench icon. We'll select it by double clicking. So we're listening to a song, no problem. We can do anything else too. What else can we do while we're waiting for the work? Feel like a game of golf? Sure. Back to golf here. And meanwhile, we still have D-Paint calculating our perspectives, although they are wrong, but it's still working in the background. No problem whatsoever here. No problems. We're ready to play golf. We'll enter a tournament. I'll play Sawgrass. So much money's on the line here. 1.5, that's enough. And we're up to the blocks. Good wind. Looks like a good drive. Now, we can always go back and look what we got here. We're still playing that sound. We've had enough of that. We'll stop that sound. So we have our golf. We'll say we've had enough of golf, because our animation's probably done by now. We'll say quit. Sure enough, it is. I'll play it back now. It won't look that good because it was the wrong inputs were put in, but we'll play it back here. We select the menu here, and we'll say control. We'll play it, we'll ping pong it back and forth, so it'll go forward and come back. This won't look so great, but give the effect of what we got here. Frames, let's play them. The only problem here is we've retained the first frame, which we're going over all the time. So we're not getting a true effect here. We can always slow this down. We can set the rate of exactly how it's going to play it. Set the rate, we'll slow it down. It's doing 30 frames per second, which if you think about it, is quite amazing. So we'll switch it to 10 frames a second to slow it down so we can have a good view of what it's doing. Control, now we'll play it again. I needed that mouse pad. So now we have nice and slow. We've seen how DCTV or how D-Paint works here, so we'll get out of here. We'll quit out of here now. Do you wish to save current changes? No. Now, the beautiful thing about the Amiga also is that we can bring in any type of graphics we want. We can just exchange their file formats with what we want. So let's say this disk right here is in IBM format. We could at any time bring this in using an MS-DOS utility to bring actually a program in. We won't do that. We'll actually go into Scala here. And we'll bring in a little demonstration of putting some of this stuff together. Right now it's reading my fonts off my hard drive again. We'll load in a script. Channel 14, I did a little thing here. And we'll run. Just a little. I did this lettering in D-Paint, which is very easy. Put a nice background on it, and I told it to bring it in. So bringing it all together in one package, it's very easy. It sits there and waits. And keeps sliding it in. Very easy effect. Very easy. Anytime we can quit out of it. We will quit out of that for now. And that's a good graphical representation of the Amiga, Mark, so it's all up to you.
Excellent, Len. That was pretty amazing stuff that you're working on. I know you're going to stay. Len's going to stay with us for the rest of the show and work on a few other things on the Amiga. We're going to open up the phone lines right now, 645-3232. So anybody who has any questions on the Amiga systems or for the Amiga users group, feel free to give us a call right now. We're going to go to the interview that we had at the the International Center with Malcolm Robbins from Sharp. So off to the interview. Here with Malcolm Robbins of Sharp Electronics. Malcolm, maybe you can fill us in a bit on Sharp's advances in technology.
Well, here at the show, we're basically featuring a lot of the products related to color and color presentation devices. And one of the major areas that we have felt very important is the ability to provide simple technologies to produce color input and output for businesses and educators to use.
This machine right here is the new color scanner.
Yes.
Maybe you can give us a little bit of an example on what types of applications it could be used for.
Okay, this color scanner is one of the models that has a large format. It allows you to use inputs up to 11 by 17.
So maybe you can give me a little bit of knowledge on how the color scanner works.
Okay, the scanner works directly with any popular microcomputer, PC or Apple Macintosh, via a special interface that's required that comes with the scanner for that product, and then you use your standard color software, which is in presentation graphics software or standard even desktop publishing type software, and they have a device driver which allows the scanner to function with that application package as an input. So you can take a photograph, for example, or even a color slide. This allows you to do slides and transparencies on this unit and scan it in, and then the picture will come up on your computer screen. At that point, you have decisions as to what you want to do with that image, if you want to incorporate it into other software for a printout, or you can send it even and do color separations in the computer from that photograph and send it directly to what we call a film recorder to produce master plates for a printing press.
That's excellent. So you really see a lot of advantages in the world to come in color technology.
Absolutely, and the devices that we have are rapidly becoming easier to use and much smaller. So we also have the same kind of device at half this size, a lot less costly, that's used even for small education classrooms and for scanning in even items like a butterfly and then being able to show it on the screen in a classroom environment.
Very good. Thank you very much, Malcolm. Back to the show. And back to the show. Welcome, Vince Marchisano.
You did it.
Nice to have you here.
Yeah, that was excellent representation. Thank you for bringing Len onto the show. And we'd like to talk now a little bit about the Hamilton Amiga Users Group. You're the president, head honcho, big cheese.
Brand new.
Excuse me.
Maybe you can tell us a little bit about the Hamilton Amiga Users Group while the phone calls stack up and take it from there.
We can tell you about it. The Hamilton Amiga Users Group was set up a few years back. It was an offshoot of Track 36, and it was created by the illustrious Dave Duncan, who's probably out there watching tonight. Mm-hmm. Dave was the ex-president. He just stepped down. He had computer burnout, finally, after all these years. Used to get a lot of phone calls, and he actually established the core of the Amiga group. I think he sold more Amigas than Commodore. He's been around for quite a while. He set it all up. It's evolved from a very small group of, geez, I guess it was about 10 people or so, and it grew to, I think we have close to 200 members now.
Very good.
And we hold our meetings now every month, except in the summer, and they're at the Spectator Auditorium.
Right. I understand that your next meeting also is an open house.
Yeah, it's an open house. Anybody who wants to come along, we'd like everybody to come down, see what the Amiga can do. You don't have to have an Amiga to come down.
No.
And I guess, when is it? It starts, it's Tuesday, April 23rd, and it's at 7 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
It's a half hour earlier than normal because we're going to be doing some children's software.
Yes.
And we'd like to get the kids down there earlier so that they can go home a little earlier and just fall asleep.
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
There are a lot of applications available in the education area for the Amiga group, too.
Oh, yeah. Quite a few. Trouble is trying to remember them all.
Excellent. So you can contact Vince at 528-9630 for more information. We'll be going over that number a little later in the show. And we understand, how are you making out over there, Len?
Good, very good.
Good. What are you working on?
I just set up a little animation. I thought you should replace your first one. A real good one. One that worked out better than mine.
Okay.
It's ready for you whenever you're ready.
Okay. Good stuff. So, yeah, it's funny. You know, we were talking a little bit before the show and talking about the differences in the IBM users and the Amiga users and the Apple users and how everybody gets segmented it's really
They have their
amazing.
Own little, yes, they seem to be, well, the IBMs are the IBMs and the Apples are Apples and invite the IBM people to the Apples and it's like, what do you mean? Why would I go there? But the whole idea is to open yourself up to see everything that is out on the market.
And that's the great opportunity that a computer club offers.
Right.
Because, let's say, is there a membership fee that goes along with becoming a member of the group?
Right. We charge $20 a year. That's for the entire family.
Mm-hmm.
And that allows you to come to the meetings. We have a library of discs, public domain material that you can come around and just take at each meeting. There's no charge for that. We have videos. And we have a club disc, like most clubs do, and a newsletter. A lot of networking, which is the most important part of the meetings. We have our SIGs. We have guest speakers. Basically, anything that you want to learn. But the most important thing about the clubs, and that's any club, is that the networking between people is to, you know, like if you have a question, you can ask it there. There's always somebody who has an answer. If you're trying to find some public domain material that you desperately need, coming to me and asking me if I know such and such a program exists is really hard because I can't remember them all. But there's always somebody at a meeting who will remember it. And that's the most important thing, is the networking.
Mm-hmm.
When you were talking about SIGs, I know what SIGs are.
Right.
Maybe you can expand on what a SIG is and what you do in those meetings.
Well, basically, at each meeting, we like to have a question and answer period. We go through club news. And then someone like Len would sit down. For instance, let's say he's got Scala. And since it's a relatively new product, at some point soon, I'm sure the meeting coordinator or myself will go up to him now and say, hey, Len, how are you going to do this at one of the club meetings? He will have a... Somewhere during the meeting, we'll sit him down. Either he'll do an open display to the entire group, or people who are interested will get into a SIG and go in the corner, and Len will show them how to use it. And it's a good way for people to see a new product. Okay, we also, each meeting, because we have quite a few new members every time, we have a workbench and usually a CLI, command line interface, SIG, so that they can learn, you know, just the basics. Now, we try to give them as much as possible at these meetings, but obviously you can't give them everything. So that's where classes or networking with other people comes in handy. Somebody can always help you. It's when you're stuck at 4 o'clock in the morning, you know, and
yes.
And you go,
and you wish you could call someone.
Well, we used to be able to call Dave at 4 in the morning, but not anymore. But that's basically what the SIGs are, the really little training, little mini training periods.
So special and interest groups.
Special interest groups, yes.
Very good.
And the meetings are, where are the meetings held?
Oh, at the Spectator on Fridge Street, and it's in the auditorium. It's a nice large auditorium. We have lots of room for a few hundred people in there. That's quite a bit.
Excellent. Sounds like a lot of fun. And this is where the new users, people that don't have computers yet and are looking at buying computers, can just come down and take a look at what the Amiga has to offer. And it gives people a good idea without the pressure of let's say, you know, having to buy one right away type thing.
Well, that's a nice thing about it. People can just come in and ask questions about it, look around. When people come into my store and ask me, you know, like, where can I see it in operation, or how can I talk to people, then I invite them down to come to a meeting, and they come in as a guest. And that's what this open house is about, that we have once a year. It's a chance to come in and talk to anybody. Like a lot of people seem to think that just if you have an Amiga, you know, or you have an IBM, you can't have an Amiga. Well, a lot of Amiga users either have an IBM bridge board in their machine, or they have an XT or AT on the side.
So what is a bridge board?
The bridge board? Len could probably explain it best, but basically what it is, it's a shrunk down IBM clone that's put right inside the Amiga, basically goes into the 2000 or the 3000, and it allows the Amiga operator to also operate IBM material. Usually the IBM material works in one little window, as we saw earlier when he was multitasking. He can have an IBM function happening, he can pull the window off to the corner and let it do what it's got to do, and he'll go on and play golf. That's all he ever does is play golf. You know? But that's the basic idea. Now, there are some functions that the Amiga needs to make use of the IBM. And that's one of the things that Len really comes into, because when you're using the animations, up to now they've been using a Targa board, and that's the IBM base. Len could probably explain more about that if you know.
You're doing great.
Yeah.
Good, so that gives you the best of both worlds. If, say, you had IBM software that you wanted to run, but still you had a creative flair and you wanted to get into animation and graphics, and you can...
Well, most people who want the IBM capabilities usually do it because they're working in an IBM-type environment at work, and they have to bring work home and finish some. But, you know, they come in, they go into a store or to a meeting, and they see all these great graphics or, you know, animations or just the multitasking alone. And they're going, wow, I got to have this. So, but they need both. And if they're trying to conserve a bit, then they put it together. They put the bridge board in the 2000. And they do have the best of both worlds. You know.
Excuse me.
That's excellent.
Okay. Maybe we should go to our first caller. Hi, Dave.
Hi.
Hi. How are you doing this evening?
Not bad. Yourself?
Great. What can we help you with?
Well, actually, I had a couple of questions.
Mm-hmm.
One, the standard out there in the business world seems to be the IBM. What would they think would be the benefit of an Amiga over an IBM, and what would it cost to get into a system, comparative system on the two, either the Amiga or the IBM?
Yeah, do you want to handle that, Vince, or?
I have to repeat the question.
What is the benefit that you feel for the Amiga compared to the IBM?
I guess if you're into the creative field, that's the first thing. If you're basically just into word processing, then I don't usually suggest the Amiga. A very simple XT or AT, whatever will do. But with the Amiga, you can go wild. That's a nice thing about it. You can do your animations if you're into animations. I do graphic artwork, and I do comic strips, so I use the computer to draw. I have an easel, or I'm getting pretty good at drawing with the mouse. I never thought I could do it. So I do graphics. People like Len, for instance, he does a lot of animations. He can't draw, but he likes to do animations. Other people, for instance, one person who's just got set up, he's doing wedding videos. There's a few businesses in town that use him for videos, titling, etc. And it can still do all the business applications, spreadsheets, databases, word processing. The nice thing about the word processing on the Amiga is that you can have full color text, full color drawings imported into it. And the basic thing behind all of it is it's creative. If you want a creative system, really creative, and you want to be able to do everything except, you know, wash dishes with it, then you go ahead and you get an Amiga.
Wow.
We're trying to figure out a way to do that, you know?
I've been trying.
But that's basically what that has to do. Whereas the PC, in a lot of cases, is limited unless you get into the high end with the VGA, and then they got some really beautiful graphics. Mm-hmm. I've seen some animations. I find them slow, but I've also seen some really nice stuff done on the IBM as well. But at the price,
there is a good comparison between your IBM, your compatibles, and the Amiga. So.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Does that help you out, Dave?
Well, that, and I just wondered what the price actually was to get started in a system.
There's the big thing. Mm-hmm. You have a multitasking machine with heavy graphics, probably some of the best games around, fully digital stereo sound. Now, if you came into the store and you wanted an Amiga and you just wanted to get started, you're looking at an Amiga 500 and you're looking at a monitor, the CPU, keyboard, all combined, one disk drive with half a meg of memory. Okay, the stereo sound is there, the mouse, the joystick patches are all there. I mean, those are standard. And for that, on the average rate now, you're looking around on 990 in that area. Whereas if you wanted to do all that on an IBM, an IBM clone, then you're looking at a lot more money because everything is extra. And that's, again, the same thing with the Amiga, is that it's all standard. The multitasking is standard. You don't need Windows. Okay, so you're getting a lot of bang for your buck, mm-hmm. basically there. You know, that's the nice thing about it. That's what makes the Amiga so attractive. All that creativity and all that power, and it's so cheap.
Excellent. Does that help you, Dave?
That's very good. I wanted to thank Vince for that, and thanks, Lynn. It was a nice demo. You guys have a good night.
Thank you. Yeah, that's the creativity part. A lot of people, when they first get a computer system, say, I don't know, how many people have we talked to that say, oh, well, I bought a computer to do household budgeting.
Yes.
And
but this is where they have to go through the education, the learning process of it all, mm-hmm. to find out what it will. Because even your compatibles and everything else, you can get into the graphics, and it'll still do all of your word processing and your spreadsheets, and you can do an awful lot with it.
So you can take a look.
You have your high end and so on. I think maybe we should go to another call for a quick second, then we'll talk about it after.
Okay.
Hi, Tammy.
Hi.
Hi, how are you doing this evening?
Fine. I'd like to thank Glenn for that excellent demo, and we were wondering what PIS was on Scala.
Excuse me?
Your program PIS? I believe that was what it was called. We were wondering what it was.
Oh, Professional Information System Setup.
Okay, we just were curious as to the title name. It was kind of odd.
I did it late at night, and I have to code all my work. It's easiest way.
That program there, what all does it entail?
Scala is a professional presentation package from GVP, and what we have running here is it'll let you bring in all your animation or IFF pictures into it and format it easily. Like right now, for instance, I have we have a little script right in front of us, nice and easy, almost driven. So I can say I can delete that one for now. Say, sure, we want to delete that. I'll start my first script with running an animation. And second, I'll say, okay, now I want to show a picture. And it says, where do you want to find the pictures? And I'll tell it to go to DH5. And I'll say, show a picture of a cat. And there's my cat. We'll say finished, okay. And we have an animation I've included, plus a picture. We can give it a wipe. What kind of wipe we want? Oh, we'll give it a nice fancy wipe. And we'll give the baby killer a nice fancy wipe. Okay. And then once we have it done, just say run. It'll get itself set up. There's a nice Channel 14 demo. Sit there for 5 seconds like we told it to. It'll wipe right into the picture of the cat. I should give it a longer delay for the cat. But at any time, we can just go in here and say, okay, wait a minute, that picture's not there long enough. Let's change that.
How many different pictures can you put on there?
Scala's very intelligent. It'll load as much as it can in memory, so it won't have to access your hard drive to slow down your presentation. But at the same time, let's say if you're loading in 5 pictures, at a certain time, it'll know it doesn't have to retain the last 3 pictures in memory, so it'll load the next 3 ahead of time to save itself speed. And that's where.
So you could run, let's say, a full presentation for a business, let's say, or for a presentation for a school package or a program for school or project or something along that line.
Right off Scala. Also with Scala, you're allowed to add in buttons to show a path of where you want to go. If I said, let's go into Baby Killer, that's what I called that cat. He's a mean cat. Okay. We'll go in here and we'll say, change it. I'll say, let's make a button there. And we'll make a button on his face. We just scroll around, and that is now a button. Now, when we click on that button, we're given a choice of what we actually want to do. Right now, we only have 2 things happening in our script, but we can tell it. That's button 1. Let's tell it to do that animation as soon as we click on his face. Or we can tell it, well, I'll just show it again. Okay? So we can run that, say, finished. Okay, run it. It's going to sit for 5 seconds and wait for our wait. Now it's going to sit there. Now we don't see the button, but there's actually a button right there. We could have clicked on it to bring up the cat right away, again, instead of going into the animation. It's a very small script, but you could place, let's say, 99 buttons all around one screen with different text on it saying, if we say here, we can change this one and put text in here. We'll say, we'll change the text to a nice small text. Swiss. Okay.
Do you have an Amiga, Tammy?
Yes, there's one right here in front of me.
Excellent. What do you do with yours?
Drawing, mainly.
Drawing? Have you tried to use it for video and that type of thing?
Yes.
Excellent. Yeah, this would be an excellent package for that type of thing.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. Where could I pick something like this up?
Probably at one of the local computer dealers. And if you'd like more information, you can give Vince a call at 528-9630.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Okay, you're welcome. You may even want to go to the Amiga users group.
Because I'm sure that they will be showing that program. Of mm-hmm. course, a good way to find out whether you really like it instead of spending the money on it first.
That's right. And yeah. You can see the
That's
killer
what they do.
Cat.
You talked them into it. I don't have to do it now.
You don't want to see it. You don't want to.
Okay, I think we'll go to another call. Hi, okay. Ernie.
Yeah, hi.
How are you doing this evening?
Okay. I just wanted to answer to your question there.
Oh.
The ham is ham, this Holden modifier.
Now, what does that mean?
Well, it has to do with graphics. I think your gentleman out there can explain it better.
Okay.
Okay.
Thanks
you very
a lot,
much
Ernie.
For calling.
You're welcome.
Bye for now. Okay, Len.
Yes,
the ball's in your court. What does hold and modify mean, and what does it do?
Okay. We'll get out a scala here. Or, no, we won't get out a scala. We'll just go back to our workbench, and we'll load up. We will load up dpaint. No, we won't show up dpaint. I'm sorry. We'll load up scala. We will load in a ham picture to show you the difference between the high resolution picture and a ham picture. So we'll say new, and our next picture is going to be chipmunk.
Killer chipmunk?
No. He's a dead chipmunk. He saw the killer cat. Now, if we say C, that is a hold and modify picture. What we have here is a low resolution picture with 4,096 colors. Okay. It's special. We're using a special graphic chip to actually attain this. You won't see another system with 4,096 colors available on board. That's an advantage that we were speaking of with the Amiga that Vince was saying, that we don't have to buy a VGA card. We don't have to buy an EGA card. We don't have to buy an EGA, LGA, or whatever. It's all on board. We have our 4,096 colors now. We have our high resolution graphics now. We have our low resolution graphics now. We have our animation now. We have it all now.
That's pretty amazing. This is what they're talking about in multimedia.
Yes.
In being able to take all of the, let's say, word processing mm-hmm. and spreadsheets and graphs and pictures and really put together a neat presentation. And with that, remember we were talking about last week, the taking the TV program?
Yes.
That's, I think it was $495, and you can have the TV, you know, have a TV in the corner and then grab a frame mm-hmm. and take different pictures from those. So that would assist in this type of presentation.
Well, that's the major difference between the IBM and the Amiga. With the Amiga, that picture of the cat that we had was actually a digitized picture of my own cat. The hardware itself cost $80, and the software is included. That's not a $500 package, it's an $80 package. So everyone can use it.
Excellent.
That's a good price. Very good.
Next. So how long has the Amiga group been operating now?
Oh, geez. It's got to be at least 4 or 5 years now.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to remember. Time is going by fast.
Yeah, I believe Len said something around 1987.
In 1987, they rolled off the...
Yeah, and he's had the Amiga since it started. So he's very well versed on the programs and computer.
I think I've had mine for about five, mm-hmm. 6 years now. 5 years? Yeah.
Excellent. How long have you been in computers, Len?
Since high school. A couple years. It's just that I started with an Apple, because Apples were the first ones to actually show color, give you colors. Now we have the Amiga, and I'm quite happy.
Great. How long do your meetings usually last?
They usually go from, the normal meetings go from 7:30 till about 9:30, 10. We usually try to finish off by 10 o'clock. That's so that we can have our after meeting at the local bistros, you know. That's where all the good stuff comes out.
Excellent. So
it's a social outfit too, as well. Like, we don't want to just think it's just a club. We like to get together afterwards as well.
You mean computers can be fun too?
Well, of course.
Well, you have to pull yourself away from them. Remember, you become brain dead.
Yeah, once in a while, we have to get away from the machines. Though.
Oh yes.
Yes. Go to a movie or do something.
We do know that. We do try to pre-warn people about that.
Yeah, it's so funny
it
when you first start off
very
with computers.
Heavy duty.
You first start off and you find yourself at 3 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning. Mm-hmm. And it's great to be able to share these types of experiences and different problems and solutions with a group like yourself.
Yeah.
And because all of this information here, for somebody who's brand new to computers, that's walking around saying, you know, what can a computer do anyway?
First thing is you go to your computer clubs. That's the best way to start finding out and asking questions, and you find out what the system is that most suits you.
Yeah. And actually, we'll be having a full list. We'll put the full list of when all the club meetings are on the bulletin board system.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, if some of these computer club presidents and the people that are supposed to be taking care of them can return my phone calls and stuff, and then I can have all the information.
We're busy
really
people.
Really helps out. Oh, I know. But hey, I want to tell everybody else out there about their clubs. So I think maybe right now we're going to take a quick second and see what is happening with Kids Corner. So let's go visit Betty.
Thanks, Mark and Ruth Ann. My name is Betty, and I'm your hostess for Kids Corner. And with us today is Robbie. And Robbie's going to show us a little program on time. Right, Rob?
Right.
Okay. Now we're going to we're going to press number 3. Okay. And the H for the hour. What time do we have? First, 3:45. Okay.
H.
Right. Now you have to keep pressing the H until we come to 3:45. Whoop, passed it. Okay, we'll go back around again. This program teaches a child how to tell time and how to relate to the numbers. Okay, now we go to minutes. That's the M.
What?
That's okay. Keep pressing.
20, 25,
30, 35.
There
we go. What time do we have now?
It's
3:45, right?
Yep.
Okay, now move hands, then press enter to answer. And we'll press the enter key.
Yep.
Right. Plays a little tune for us. Okay, now we have another one. 9:45. Let's pick that one out. Okay, hours.
Nine. 45.
Your minutes. There. Now we can press enter. See if we get another tune. Very good. Excellent. And there goes the mouse across the screen. One more time. Shall we try it again? Programs are very simple and they're educational for the children.
Minutes.
Minutes, 5:30. Great. All right. Very good. All righty. Well, I think that should be wrap it up for us today, eh, Rob?
Yep.
Okay, thanks for being with us.
Welcome.
Back to Ruth Ann and Mark.
And Vince and Len.
Yes.
With the Hamilton Amiga Users Group. This is this is really excellent to get everybody involved in the shows now. Usually it's Ruth Ann having to put up with me, you know. And so now...
It's nice to be able to get such an influx because there is so much out there on the market and the companies and businesses that are around, and they're so willing to, once we contact them and stuff, and they're saying, hey, let's get some, and Len is very good at showing us what it is that the system's doing.
It's really amazing.
Mm-hmm. It's very good. I think we'll go to another call. Hi, Mike.
Yeah.
Hi, how are you doing tonight?
Not too bad. I have a question for Len. We were watching the multitasking.
Mm-hmm.
Is it possible to multitask, let's say, with the printer while it's doing an animation or something like that?
I don't know, Mike. Let's try it. Let's see. Let's have Skella here still. And we're going to go in and try a desktop publishing package here. Let us try a nice product from Gold Disc called Professional Page. I have the desk jet sitting right there waiting.
So for some of the other viewers that don't understand what multitasking is, maybe give a brief synopsis on what multitasking is, Len.
Okay, multitasking is the, it explains the way the computer's allowed to run. It's running more than one task at a time. So although we still have Skella sitting in the background, sitting there waiting, and of course we can go back and play music at the same time and play golf, the computer's running all at the same time, and they're all running interactive with no problems. Machine's not even breathing hard right now. It's not worrying.
Now, this machine that you have here, you've got, how much memory do you have in this machine? Because in order to be able to run all those programs, you do have to have a lot of memory, don't you?
You do have to have the memory. That is true. I have 9 megs of memory in this. I have 32-bit memory, 8 megs of it. This gives me the speed because I have an O30 board on here, a Great Valley product O30 accelerator. It's a speed I need if I'm doing really good desktop publishing or video or animation.
So this is a real enhanced computer system. What would somebody at home be looking at for this type of system going full out?
Are you asking the price on a system such as this?
Yeah.
Hmm. Well, without getting right into dollars and cents, it'd be comparable to a Mac system, okay? We have the speed of the Mac. We have the speed of the 386 right here. We're playing in this. We're in the same racetrack as them. Actually, we're even faster. We have, like we were mentioning earlier, we can emulate the we can emulate IBM programs. We can also emulate Mac systems, Atari systems, Commodore 64 systems. So, what we're looking at here right now is not just the Amiga. We have everything.
So this is and plus this type of computer is. Acts as a total business in itself, wouldn't it?
That's right.
So it wouldn't be that much of an investment. Say what, $5,000-$6,000
for a full blown system, of course. Yeah.
Excellent. Well, that I mean, you know, for all the
for
businesses
that
you can
does,
get
yeah.
into, I mean, that's not very. You know, you've got multimedia, you've got multitasking, you've got presentations, desktop publishing, being able to feed out to graphics and all that type of thing.
One other thing about that is that the prices you're mentioning are higher on some, you know, higher end equipment, but this machine is replacing very expensive pieces of equipment.
Mm-hmm.
It's working its way towards replacing the paint box, which is well over $250,000. It's being used now all over the place. In a lot of art studios, it's being used in titling houses in Hollywood. Disney uses it now for their pencil testing. One of the main things most people don't realize is that one Amiga 2000 is running the entire MGM theme park.
Mm-hmm.
It has, because of its multitasking, it hooks up on different IBMs, so it controls all those IBM machines and the entire park. So it's taking a big chunk of the high-end market.
Okay.
Yeah.
So maybe if we could just finish off the question for that for Mike.
Okay.
So would he be able to work on it and do the printing at the same time? Because I have to
That's
get to
exactly
the
what I'm doing right now.
Okay.
Right now I'm outputting right to the desk jet at 300 dots
okay,
per inch.
Okay, so it will
and
do
And I'm also
it.
Running an animation, no problem
okay.
whatsoever.
Okay, very good. Excellent. Okay, does that answer your question, Mike?
Yeah,
if you're still
perfect.
There.
Thank you very much.
Okay,
thanks
great.
For
thank you very
Mike.
Much. Okay, I'll go to another caller. Hi, Al. Yeah, we got off track there for a second. Hello, Al.
Yeah, hi.
Hi, how are you doing this evening?
I'm fine, thanks. I just wanted to ask them, this may be a little difficult to explain, but one of the big things right now with the Amiga is the video toaster.
Mm-hmm.
What a little information on that.
This is all Len's baby. He's
okay,
worked with
Len.
It.
The video toaster. Yes.
The video toaster is a device from NewTek that enables you to do special effects with your video very easily. No longer do you have to buy $10,000, $50,000 worth of equipment. It's all built into a card that just fits into your video slot of the Amiga. So not only do you have a total business system, you also have a full video editing system. What more could you ask for, Mark?
That's excellent. So this then would replace the $50,000, you mentioned a quarter of a million dollar system, a paint box?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Those really nice animations you see in movies where they're super smooth. There's a lot of work being done on the Amiga with the 24 bit frame buffers that is going to be able to do this really super smooth animation. Right now, what a lot of production houses do is they use the Amiga as the Volkswagen, the workhorse. Mm-hmm. They do their animations on it, like Len could do an animation, say for a new movie title.
Yeah.
He would work on that on the Amiga, spend the hours necessary on there, then go to some place that has the Quantel paint box and pay the $400 an hour for an hour or two to smoothen it all out. And you get to see what you see on the screen, nice smooth graphics. But the Amiga is interloping into that now.
Excellent. Do you use your Amiga for video, Al?
A little bit, not as much as these two do, but it's very interesting. I like my Amiga.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks very much.
Excellent. Thank you. Yeah, it's amazing the attitude in the industry, you know, sometimes where the IBM people just talk about IBM, Amiga people talk about Amiga, and Apple people talk about Amiga. But being able to take all of that and use the advantages of everything in the system in one computer system is a tremendous benefit.
That's a nice thing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Would you like to go to another call? Ruthie and Ironside?
Yes, we will. Mark Ironside. Hi, Dave.
Hello.
Hi, how you doing?
Not too bad. Actually, I had phoned earlier. Had a question if I could.
Recognize voice. What can we help you with?
Two things. Vince, you look good without the pocket protector. The other question was, I hear a lot on video, and I hear something about a desktop publishing program. What about the music side of it? I know there's a lot of people interested in the MIDI control, and I know the Atari makes a big issue about it comes fully equipped for MIDI. What's the cost to get into MIDI, and what are the, is there any comparable programs between the Atari and the Amiga and the IBM and the Mac? I know also are heavy into MIDI music.
Okay, MIDI being for the viewers that don't understand what MIDI is, it's musical instrument digital interface. So it takes notes that are played in the on an instrument and translates it to computer digital language. Mm-hmm. So you want to handle that, Vince or Len?
Music is not something I'm really deep into. I find that the people who are into the music are very specialized. Len's into it a bit, but I don't think either of us are too much with that. Len, if Len has any,
a MIDI interface will cost anywhere from $50 and upwards, depending if you want, you know, your basic system or your higher system. We have a lot of good MIDI programs available for the Amiga now. It's like the third generation of programming is coming out, and now we're beginning to steal all the customers that were solid Atari MIDI users. Now they're back to the Amiga because of our programming now.
Excellent. Do you have a musical instrument, Dave?
I do, yeah. I don't have an Amiga anymore. I just got rid of mine, actually.
Mm-hmm. You wouldn't happen to be the infamous Dave Duncan that they have been talking about, would you?
Actually, I was, yes.
You was?
I am.
You are?
Will be?
Well, that's good. That's good.
Great.
Excellent. Thanks a lot, Dave.
Guys, fine job.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye for now.
Bye-bye.
Yeah, you know, that's... Computers can really become, you can overload yourself really easy on computers. You were mentioning that Dave's really really kind of burnt out a bit. And
a lot of us reach that point.
Yeah, with the club too, this is where networking talent really helps in taking everybody and relying on everybody to answer questions and develop different programs. So something like MIDI, then the music end of it would be, say, a special interest group that you would have. one.
Well, we have quite a few actually are really heavily into music. As a matter of fact, I think there should be one or two at the open house. There's a few, and they're really good. You can sit there and listen to some good music. I used to go up in Dave's when he got his, and we used to watch him play music anyway through it. But a lot of these guys can do some excellent job, and a lot of professionals are using it now. As a matter of fact, in front of the new Amiga World, Todd Rundgren, is it?
Rundgren.
He's using the Amiga. He's a big Mac user. I mean, he still likes the Mac, but he's using the Amiga now for graphics and music as well. And I guess excellent. People like B.B. King, who can't write music at all, he just plugs his guitar into the MIDI and the computer does the work for him. Out come the notes, everything.
Fantastic.
Okay, I'd like to go to another caller. Hi, Ian.
Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Great.
Good. Actually, I've got two questions. One is for Len, first of all. Mm-hmm. I'm kind of interested in what he was talking about, like putting titles onto videos and that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. How do you go about doing that with the computer? Like, you're obviously making the titles on the computer, but how do you actually get it onto your VCR then?
Okay, Ian, first of all, you need a Genlock. A Genlock's a device that'll fit right into the Amiga, or an external unit, that will blend the Amiga signal with your video signal. So what you do is, if you had your master, let's say you took a videotape of your wedding, you want to add some titles onto it, we'd get out of here, go into dpaint. Oh, got professional page running. Multitasking all over. Okay. I'll load up just dpaint again, a nice, easy titling package. So care. Load in a font. Pick a nice big font. Show a classic example of how easy video titling would be. We'll take a nice big font. We'll say hi, because it's too big anyways. So what we have here is a very simple lettering, titling. What is black on the screen would actually be your video coming in. So your video, black, would be not touched. All that would be overridden would be the red. And that's how you get your video titling. Very easy.
Oh, I see. Yeah, so it's something else you would just add onto the computer itself to be able to do that then.
Very cheap interface. Very cheap.
That's only, what, a couple hundred dollars, Len?
They can start anywhere from $85 and onwards up. Depends, again, if you want to go low-end or super high-end to go to broadcast.
Yeah. And actually, a question for Vince. Is there anybody, say, in the Hog Club that would actually, you know, if you're having a lot of problems, would they sit down and sort of show you on a one-to-one basis rather than, you know, sometimes when I go to these sort of things, I'm a little bit intimidated by, you know, everyone around, you're afraid to ask questions and that sort of thing, but is there anybody that can sit down with you on a one-to-one basis and kind of help you out if you have problems?
That's an excellent question, Ian.
Well, one of the things that I try to do, basically, is since it's very difficult on the Amiga to one person answer all the questions, I try to act as a brokerage, and when people phone me up, either at the store or at home, if I can't answer it, I usually send them to someone who can. It's the only way on this machine. There's just no way that one person is going to sit down and try to learn it all. But yeah, there's a lot of help. The club helps especially. That's what I was saying earlier about networking. That's very important. You want to come in there, meet some people, and find out who has the same interests as you. Get their phone number and then bug them all night long. And the nicest thing about it is that most of these people are very anxious and very happy to help. Mm-hmm. I haven't met one person yet who, you know, hasn't gone out of the way to help. Of course, if you call them at 5 in the morning, they might.
Or might be a little bit different.
Yeah. Excellent.
Okay.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Ian. Okay, so the Amiga Users Group is going to be meeting Tuesday, April 23rd, 7 o'clock to 9 o'clock at the Hamilton Spectator Building. And you can
take
your kids,
it's open
and
house.
You can find out more information on the bulletin board system if you want to tap into that. That's 547-5461, 547-5461 for the BBS. And thanks
we'll
a lot.
And we'll see you next week.
Don't forget the coffee.
This is Mark and Ruth Ann Ironside saying good night.
Thanks a lot, Vince and Len.
Yep. We'll be right back.